Hello, everybody. Welcome to Fat Tuesday in Vancouver, Washington. Just our little way of being festive here. Anyway, welcome all of you. We have some special awards today, and it's exciting, and the sun is out, which is beautiful. So anyway, hello. The full board's here. I'll do my duties now. Shout out. And everybody's here on the board, and we're official. And we want to start this off with a special showcase, a Design 2 showcase.
Yes, I'd like to introduce Kim Town Carlson, Executive Director of Teaching and Learning. The showcase focuses on one of our strategic initiatives centered around family engagement. So, Kim, I'll let you do the introductions.
Thank you. Dr. Wynn, members of the board, cabinet, and community guests, it's my pleasure to introduce Edward Esparza. Come on up, Eddie. Educational advocate at Martin Luther King Elementary, and Anthony Kay, attendance specialist at Fruit Valley. These two passionate, energetic, dedicated educators are going to share with you how soccer, an extended day learning program, and community partnerships all come together in a really innovative and engaging way to increase student attendance, improve academic achievement, support positive student behavior, and strengthen family connections. Please join me in welcoming Eddie and Anthony.
We're just figuring out how to advance the slides. So the question is, what if? What if we told you that we have an innovative, groundbreaking program at two Vancouver public schools which provide an innovative learning environment which engages and empowers each student to develop knowledge and essential skills to become a competent, responsible, and compassionate citizen? Well, we had such a program at King and Fruit Valley Elementary Schools, and the program has been so successful that it has branched out into 10 other schools in Vancouver, Washington.
Student-day leadership program. Our program is open to students from grades 3 to 5, and the reason for this is because we also provide additional resources supporting literacy through our community partners, which we'll name later on in this presentation. We use an extended day soccer program to motivate students to come to all school to school every day, all day. This program was developed for reaching students whose attendance is a concern. We get the names of these students from building staff and the district weekly attendance reports, which are sent to us from DART team.
How we increase student success and academic achievement? By partnering with community partners such as AC Portland, who provide opportunities for our students such as the Rose City Readers Literacy Program, we are able to have the Timbers mascot come to both schools and give a presentation on the importance of literacy. The Police Activities League, which brings officers into schools and gives books to the kids, as well as sponsors our 2 yearly soccer tournaments. The Portland Trailblazers, who gave presentations this last year on the Read Big Challenge, IQ Credit Union for providing a grant to purchase books for our students. And we also have additional community partners, which include the Vancouver Metro Sunset Rotary Club and the Fruit Valley Foundation.
Building positive working relationships with students and families. The students' families must attend a signing event where we review the program expectations. Students and parents sign the contracts, as well as take photos with the coaching staff and team. This gives them an opportunity to ask any questions they might have about the program.
Daily support for students. Daily morning check-in. Students are required to check in daily every morning with the coach where they show their signed planner and completed homework. This provides an opportunity to address any issues that may have risen outside of school and may have an impact on their success or their attendance. Also, daily practice and brief. During the morning meeting, students also practice drills for 20 to 30 minutes. And at the end of practice, it's an opportunity to come together in a family unity circle. And everybody joins together, and we put our arms around each other, and we make eye contact. And we set each other off with positive words of encouragement and inspirational quotes. and we explain our expectations of the students and give them reminders of what we need from them and also ask what they need from us.
FRAT, Family Resource Attendance Team. FRAT is made up of a building administrator, school counselor, FCRC coordinator, attendance specialist, and educational advocate. The team meets weekly to review student attendance areas of concern, as well as establishing a plan using collaboration and accountability to ensure the student and their family's needs are being addressed. FRAT removes the barriers to being in school all day, every day.
What makes our two schools unique? Well, being there for students and staff during the school day is a big part of it. In our individual roles as student advocates, we perform classroom visitations and do behavior, homework, and attendance checks. We're also there after school, and by being available after school, this allows us to be a direct connection between families and schools that would not normally happen during the school day. And also weekly attendance checks. Students understand they may not participate in soccer activities or events related to the soccer club if they do not come to school.
This program provides opportunity. Because the majority of our students' families cannot afford extracurricular sports programs, our programs are at zero cost participation. To support our zero cost initiative, we offer a clothing and equipment exchange where families can exchange their old equipment and gently used equipment, which we get donated from various community partners and school staff.
So the final question is, what now? We plan to increase the community partnerships we have already established with organizations, as we previously mentioned, Active Children Portland, Portland Timbers, Rose City Readers, Police Activities League of Vancouver, Washington, Portland Trailblazers, and Clark College. And our vision is to continue to work together and continue to build upon the success of the program. Our vision is to grow and expand to McLaughlin Middle School and Discovery Middle Schools and create a pathway between elementary school and high school, using soccer as a positive relationship model to continue increasing student outcomes by engaging both students, families, and the community as a whole, while supporting students' academics, behavior, and attendance. We believe firmly that by doing this, we are creating competent, responsible, and compassionate citizens.
Let's take a look how this all comes together.
Just a little summary real quick, in case you And the other thing too is we are a little bit nervous, we're gonna own that piece, but if you see us and how we work with the kids, you'd see that we're really excited about what we do, we're very passionate about it. So I'll tell you a little something while we get ready for the students to speak. So we'll try this again. But these are some of the kids we work with in our program, and we're very proud of them. They do great work. I currently have about 50 kids in my program at King, and Anthony's got about, how many kids have you got right now?
We got about 40 kids.
40 kids, and for both of us as young men in group in poverty, this is very important, very near and dear to us. So I'm just gonna speak a little bit, and this wasn't part of what we're gonna talk about, but figured I'll fill it with a little bit of background. So we're very passionate about this, and we appreciate the opportunity to do this and support the kids. So thank you for all of you who support what we do. And that's real life. That's one of the things we teach is problem solving. Because we want the kids to understand that you've got to be able to deal with this. And it's dear lady here, she'll speak in a minute. She talks about public speaking. And we want to make sure we captured things. We had everything written out. But if we truly spoke from our hearts, we'd be flowing, we'd be jumping all over the place and truly excited, which we are, but we're a little bit reserved. So I apologize for that. And let's see here.
Eddie?
Yeah.
We'll make sure that the board gets this URL link. I apologize for the technical challenges, but we'll get it fixed prospectively.
Thank you. Any questions?
Yeah. So, any board questions?
Eddie and Anthony gave this presentation at the Vancouver Downtown Rotary last week. They did a great job. The video work, it was a great video. In fact, they did so well, they held court afterwards because there were so many interested people that came up to speak with them. So, congratulations for that. That's a great program.
And thank you for the opportunity.
Feel bad. They were pushing all the right buttons. It's something else. I guarantee you. Sunspot.
That too. Okay, sorry.
Okay, so let's move on to one of our very special awards from some very special people, actually some excellent people. So this is February's Employee Excellence Awards, and we're going to have Kathy Everidge, who's basically the Assistant Superintendent in charge of Human Resources, and Rosemary Fryer.
Dr. Webb, members of the board, community guests, and staff, it is my privilege to present the February 2017 Employee Excellence Awards to 7 deserving members. This award recognizes individual employees for creating a positive, caring, and productive school environment through exceptional effort, dedication, and performance in their areas of responsibility. Employees are nominated by colleagues, supervisors, parents, community members, and students, and nomination forms can be found on the school district website. A panel made up of representatives from throughout the district review all nominations and selects those to receive recognition. Tonight's Excellence Award recipients are Julie McKee, Gary Yarn, Nicole Loran Graham, the Eisenhower Paraeducator team of Wendy Chopp, Lisa Lynn Gasher, Kim Luttrell, and Amber Wyckoff. If the award recipients could please join me up here at this time, I'd appreciate that. So come on up. Eisenhower Elementary Paraeducator team. So if that team could kind of step forward so we can all see you. Okay.
See, we work as a team.
So as I say your name, if you just wave it. Wendy Chopp was hired September 2013. Lisa Lynn Gasher was hired October 2013. Kim Luttrell was hired November 2008. And Amber Wyckoff was hired September 2013. So last fall, this team joined a pilot program that serves students with individual educational plans in general education classrooms. Each paraeducator's contribution is valuable. Amber is tuned into and motivated to meet the needs of all children at Eisenhower. Lisa connects well with each student in the classroom and brings flexibility and enthusiasm to her job. Kim thinks creatively when she encounters a challenge and enjoys working with students who have social difficulties. Wendy always arrives at work with a smile, ready to support students and teachers in any way she can. With open minds and hearts, these four women are working hard to ensure that their students are successful at Eisenhower. Congratulations. Next, I'd like to recognize Julie McKee. Julie McKee, if you can step forward. Julie McKee is Secretary of Special Services Department and was hired in August 1995. On top of her secretarial duties, Julie is dedicated to helping students in special education and their families make a smooth transition to school. With new special education students entering the district, when they enter, she coordinates transfer of records so that the VPS administrators can review them and make an appropriate placement for the students. And she also arranges transportation for the children. Over the summer break, Julie is busy ensuring that students are ready to change grades or schools and connecting with families to get updated information. Say her coworkers. Her positivity and can-do attitude are contagious and contribute to an improved morale for everyone fortunate enough to come in contact with her. Congratulations. Next, I'd like to recognize Gary Yarn. Gary.
Hi,
Gary. Gary is a graphic technician in the curriculum department, and he was hired in April 2010. Among Gary's many duties is a creation of the Programs of Choice flyer that is distributed to more than 10,000 families. For many of them, the flyer is their first introduction to the myriad specialized learning opportunities offered at the secondary level. Gary is tasked with making the document look professional and presenting the information in an accessible, coherent manner. Not only is he able to do this, he is also diligent and remains flexible when last-minute changes are required. Happens often. Said his nominator, It is a pleasure to work with someone so dependable and professional who produces quality work. Congratulations. And now I'd like to recognize Nicole Grand Graham. She is a coordinator for the Mobile Family Community Resource Center, and she was hired in September 2015. A parent submitted the following nomination. My family is homeless at the moment, and Nicole has gotten me in touch with agencies that can help. She has got my family enrolled for housing, college bound, Santa Posse, food, gas, and Winco cards. I will be forever grateful to her for her help, compassion, and empathy. If it were not for her and Geyser Middle School resources, my family would have no hope and not know who to get in touch with. I will be paying everything forward once my family is back on our feet. Nicole is a gift to my family. Congratulations.
Very proud of these people that are standing before us. They show the community, they show the children that combined with the power of love and the power of brains, you can do anything. And they transfer that because you give them that power of love every day that you go to work and you find out how to meet their needs and you just love them. And you love our most vulnerable students and you love our brightest students. You love them all. And we can't do education without love. That's the power. And so thank you for doing that every single day and loving our kids.
So we have some speakers tonight, and Kay Ellison is first. Welcome to the podium. You get 3 minutes to address the board, and if you have any written materials, please. Also, if there isn't enough time for 3 minutes, so please state your name, your address.
Okay. Can you hear me? Okay, yes. My name is Kay Ellison, but I'm really here as a retired teacher librarian since last June. And I had the pleasure to be a librarian at Marshall Elementary for 23 years, ever since it was built. And I got to have the pleasure of getting to wear a hard hat into the building before it actually had been opened. So that was exciting. And I really did get to know that building in 23 years. And the janitors would come through and the district workmen coming through to get up to the ceilings. So I really got to know whatever was wrong in the building. And there was a problem that I think we can fix, that is with a new building. We had gas, heat, and there were leaks among the years, and they were really hard to find. And I think there were other problems with efficiency. If you tried to heat one, I was in the library. There's the library, the gym, and the music room in this building. It was separate from the main building. It is. And if you tried to raise the heat in one room, then the heat in another room would go way bonkers, either high or off. And then the music room was like that all the time. First of all, thank you that you're considering new buildings. It's really exciting. Thank you. But I'm hoping that in the new buildings that you'll consider some non-fossil fuels. I think that having a heat pump at my house that's very efficient and there wouldn't be leaks and things that would be dangerous for people. So anyway, thank you for what you're doing. It's exciting. I'm proud to be part or have been part of Vancouver School District. So thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak to you today. My name is Lehman Holder, and I'm very happy to say I pay my school taxes every year because I think schools are a critical and critically important part of our society. Earlier this month, I was told that the Vancouver schools had received authorization to spend $551 million for new and remodeled schools and buildings. I'm concerned about what kind of heating systems these schools will have. Climate change is on everyone's mind, and as I understand it, most of the heating for schools comes from natural gas, a fossil fuel that contributes to CO2 in the Earth's atmosphere, and that's a major contributor to climate change. I'd like to suggest that the facility superintendent create a Citizens Energy Advisory Panel. I believe the school board should be encouraged to instruct architects to design efficient, all-electric buildings having large arrays of solar panels with the goal of transitioning away from fossil fuels as much as possible. The solar panels could be integrated into the grid. Ideally, new buildings should produce more energy than they consume. I'm not sure what the best path forward might be, but I've learned that schools in Vancouver, BC plan to require all new buildings to be heated with electricity by 2030. Governor Inslee is proposing a carbon tax to encourage us to use less fossil fuel. Carbon pricing systems are already in place in California, Oregon, and British Columbia. The cost of natural gas is almost certainly going to go up. Also, I believe the district should consider more built-in conservation measures and practices. Lighting should dim in empty hallways and classrooms when not in use. Trophy cases don't need to be lit at night or on the weekends, and soft drink machines shouldn't be lit at all. It's pretty clear that we may not get any meaningful action at the national level for several years. So it seems that we need to lead by example here at the local level. I ask that the school board do its part in addressing climate change. Thank you.
Thank you, Lima.
Hello, board and staff and community members. I am also here from where I live, where I'm raising a grandchild who attends Marshall Elementary, and things probably from Ms. Ellison, to talk about sustainable building. All electric, solar-powered school buildings throughout Vancouver School District are the right choice. In this boldness has genius, power, and magic in it moment. The bond measure passed. The community is galvanized and looking for practical ways to create a positive future for our children. The Vancouver Board has the opportunity to affirm that science, technology, engineering, and math matter, and to lead to practical solutions we can use right now in building super efficient all-electric buildings. I urge you to commit to passing policy that all new construction and remodeling will be electric and super efficient. Do this even if there are questions about how to make this happen. Trust that the moment one definitely commits oneself, then Providence moves too. The community that passed the bond will support you in making sustainable choices. There are so many people looking for ways to contribute to a positive future for our children. Commit to building super efficient, all-electric future, the Vancouver School District, and let the students, parents, and community at large be part of making it happen. This is a real life STEM curriculum on steroids learning opportunity. We all need to learn how to transition from fossil fuels to climate-friendly choices, and we need to learn it now. Thank you very much for your time.
Hello, and thank you for the opportunity to address you. I'm Mike Ellison, and I grew up and I'm a product of the Vancouver Public Schools. I'm a former high school science teacher and lifelong science educator and science education researcher. The recently passed bond gives you the opportunity to consider alternatives to fossil fuel-based heating and cooling systems in new and remodeled schools. I'd like to suggest, as I'm reinforcing what other people have said, but consider the opportunity to inspire students to learn about the natural science and social science of energy use and conservation through the use of energy-efficient building designs, such as has been suggested already. The students that will learn in these buildings will be hearing more and more about the challenges of climate change. Energy-efficient buildings will provide motivating contexts for understanding the science of energy and climate change, as well as the civics of promoting wise decision-making through our elected representatives. And as has been mentioned, we need to look to ourselves at the local level for leadership. So take advantage of this learning opportunity for our students. Thanks.
Thank you, Mike.
Hello, everybody. I'm Don Steinke. Local elected officials have told me, yes, we need to address climate change, but we can't do anything about it in Vancouver. Not true. Either they don't believe climate science, or they're not paying attention. Local elected officials tell me, we need to address climate change, but that needs to be addressed at the federal level. I say hogwash. We've been waiting for the federal government to act for 30 years. It is way past time for local elected officials to recognize they have a role to play in addressing climate change. The Vancouver School District can stop investing money in new fossil fuel infrastructure, such as heating systems that require fossil fuels. New schools should go all electric, no natural gas. Your criteria should not be limited to the cost of the fuel, but should include the cost of the impacts. It should also factor in the carbon taxes that Governor Inslee is proposing right now to discourage us from using fossil fuels and to use the money for schools. $20 billion. As elected officials, your job is to make policy. Not have it handed to you by staff. As a school board, you have an obligation to do what's best for our young people. You have a public trust obligation to do what you can to protect the future, their future, from climate chaos. Add it to your agenda tonight to discuss the question of whether or not the Vancouver School District should spend money on new fossil fuel heating systems. Then have a workshop on it at your next meeting. Then make policy before any contracts or designs are settled. Vancouver, Canada says LEED Platinum is not good enough. Tell your staff and architects to spend no money on new fossil fuel infrastructure. The most important time to say that is when new facilities are being planned. Last year, the Portland City Council banned all new fossil fuel infrastructure because they want to do their part to prevent an expansion of the fossil fuel industry. Charlie Hales was reluctant at first, but after he had an audience with the Pope, he became a champion of the proposal. I'll stay around to see what replies you have tonight. Thank you. And I'll give a copy of this to everybody.
Good evening. Alona Steinke. The Vancouver School District will have $550 million to work with. What a wonderful opportunity to use this to truly invest in our children's future by making environmentally responsible decisions when designing new buildings or remodeling older facilities. Using renewable energy, electricity systems, lots of natural light, water-saving features, and indoor air quality measures should be high priority. Using natural gas for heating should not even be considered. In spite of the way it is marketed, natural gas is not a clean fuel. It is dirty, beginning with its origin in the fracking fields. There are methane leaks the length of the pipelines. The EPA has said that the gas industry leaks 1.4% of what it produces, and that gas is 80 times more potent than CO2 as a greenhouse gas. I really like this statement by the Green School Alliance. They say, "We envision a world where every person is aware of and accountable for the impact they have in creating an environmentally, economically, and equitably sustainable future." I trust that this will be your vision as well.
Thank you, Lana. Thank you, folks, for your input this evening. We will move on with our current agenda this evening. The need a motion for consent agenda.
So moved.
Can I get a second?
Second.
All right. Any discussion? No discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Dr. Webb, we have a recommendation.
Just a superintendent's report. Yes. As the board is aware, we are facing an impending levy cliff rollback from 28% to 24%, which impacts not just our levy collection amount, but also levy utilization. I'm going to have Brett walk through the potential impacts and then respond to any questions. Brett?
All right.
You don't need sound, do you?
I just have a short video I'd like to play for you. So thank you, Dr. Webb. I won't go through all of the elements of the levy cliff since we briefed you last month on those, but just to anchor our discussion today, the key amounts that we've talked about are about for the 2017-18 fiscal year or school year, about $3.25 million, and then it grows to $4.6 million the following fiscal year. The Columbian reported a different number, a little over $4 million. That's on a calendar year basis, and so since it's most impactful to our budget on a fiscal year basis, I've converted the calendar year implications of this into our fiscal year. So that's where you see those differences. Obviously, the key issue that districts like us have struggled with and some will continue to struggle with is, at what point do we have to make commitments to staff associated with this insecurity of our funding? And so if we were to, just to give some context, if we were to isolate all of the 3.25 reductions into our certificated instructional staff, so that's our teachers, our librarians, our counselors, basically not the administrative staff, but all the other certificated staff in our district, it would equate to about 36 positions that we would have to look at reducing in order to rebalance our budget. If we were to concentrate all of those reductions in the administrative sector of our employees, it would be about 20 full-time equivalents. And then lastly, if we were to just look at the average, we have a broader spectrum of classified employees, but if we were to look at the average of our classified employees, to achieve the 3.25 million, we would have to reduce 46 FTE. Another way of looking at it is to say, okay, if we were to distribute the 3.25 in reductions proportionately amongst our employees, the pro rata distribution you can see would be 25 certificated instructional staff, 2 administrators, and 10 classified staff. And the reason that our district and others have struggled with this issue is many of the collective bargaining agreements and Washington statutes call for action well in advance of when the state will likely resolve the issue. And so we are very fortunate in Vancouver because we have a couple things that I believe will allow us to not be insulated from the impact, but at least be insulated from the trauma and stress of having to go through reductions in force as a result of this possibility. The first thing we looked at, and Kathy and the HR team did a great job of looking over the last several years at what type of attrition patterns we have. either for retirement, for leaves, or leaving the district for other employment. And we feel comfortable that if we had to make adjustments in our staffing, we can achieve that through attrition versus having to do a formal reduction of force where we're notifying existing employees that they may not have a position next year. The second thing that we have, which is really unique for Vancouver, and we're very fortunate to have, is the additional fund balance that we've reserved for, at one point, the notion of the match required for our kindergarten through third grade class size reduction facilities grant. Now that we passed the bond, we're able to use bond resources to match the state grant that we got for kindergarten through third grade class size enhancements. So that would free those funds up on a short-term basis to provide a bridge around the levy cliff issue. And again, having gone through all the planning, it's prudent and necessary for us to have these contingency plans. But again, I just want to remind and anchor the point that we don't believe that at the end of the day, the legislature may back many districts into this corner, but at the end of the day, we believe the funding will be secure. It's just a question of whether districts will have to act preemptively. And again, I think we're in a very, very unique and fortunate position that we will not have to take those draconian steps just preemptively while they continue the political debate in Olympia.
As the board is aware, during the Great Recession, we created a workforce stabilization reserve, used that ending fund balance as a way of smoothing the effects of budget shortfalls year over year. And again, this is a contingency. We fully expect our legislature to step up and respond to McCleary. Absent that, we fully expect them to kick the can and extend the levy lid provisions for at least one more year while they dicker about this in Olympia. Substitute House Bill 1059 is stalled in the Senate. I forwarded some information to you this afternoon related to a regional letter signed off by every superintendent in Region 112 to our respective senators in the region, asking them to get this thing moving. We have an A1 deadline notice requirement to our certificated staff. Some districts have deadlines that are before then, and as you recall, we have an April 30th deadline in the provision of this particular bill that has to be met. Absent that, then there's an abeyance on the rollback. So the longer we wait in terms of getting this resolved, the more difficult it is from a planning and operation perspective.
Interesting.
So Britt, even though based on your presentation, the levy, the loss of the millions of dollars won't affect us in terms of layoffs, you're still having to prepare parallel budgets, right?
Absolutely.
One, assuming the loss of the money and then the other.
Absolutely, yes.
Yeah. And when did we get our first look at that? Budget proposals? I mean, like what we're going to do.
Yeah, that'll depend on how quickly the legislature wraps up their consensus budget. The details related to the two bills in which the vehicles for the Senate plan and the Republican plan, 5607, in 1843, there are just so many assumptions and variables in there, it's almost guesswork in terms of how to forecast what the implications are relative to the localized impact of those budgets. So once there's greater certainty around a McCleary solution, we'll bring that to you as quickly as we can once we have time to do the analysis.
I imagine you're doing some preliminary planning, but really we could be waiting much longer than we waited in past years to start
The latest we, in my decade here, the latest we received a consensus budget was at the end of June.
It would probably be a good idea if we as board members email and explain to them that, because they're sitting on it, you know, the Senate is sitting on it, because they're using it in a bargaining chip in this McCleary solution that they're trying to come to. So it would probably be a good idea if we all, as individual board members, emailed and said, you have to understand that we can't wait until April 30th or May 30th, whenever they're going to get around to doing this, that we really need them to pass, you know, about 10:59, so that they can, so that we don't have to keep all the guesswork going. I mean, it's affecting all the districts in the whole state. And,
I think the arguments on both sides are really reasonable from a certain perspective, because if they don't address the levy cliff, a lot of people believe that will put significant pressure on solving the McCleary. And so that's a good thing. We want them to solve the McCleary this year. But other people think if you, you know, there's pros and cons. If you get rid of the levy cliff, that gives no pressure. There's no pressure. They can delay as much as they want. You know, so I think that it's almost like, what do you have faith in? Do you have faith if you get rid of the levy cliff problem that people of good faith will do the right work by the deadline? And so,
we understand that the revenue forecast, state revenue forecast, is March 16th. According to our contacts in Olympia, there should be some movement here with another vehicle for a McCleary solution shortly thereafter. So we'll see if that actually materializes. But the sooner all the markers are out, the sooner we can get into conference and figure out how to broker a deal. And the longer the dicker, the longer we wait, and the more difficult it is, not just for Vancouver Public Schools, but the other 294 districts across the state to plan.
Right, who don't have the ending fund balances that we do, and they also, importantly, don't have the staffing. They don't have a CFO on staff. They don't have people who can react in real time to numbers and to the other things. So they're, you know, we're very fortunate that we have those gifts here.
All right, any other questions?
Yeah. All right. Good. Thank you, Brett.
So, Dale, I had a question for you.
Sure.
I know it's not on the agenda, but we had a request from our people who testified. I just thought you could explain how the board handles public comment so that people know that we heard them and what our procedures are.
Right. So, we want to anyone on any topic, we gather the information, we go to what you say, we gather what you read, and then we digest it and figure out where to go next from here. So we don't engage in conversations directly, but we want to hear the perspective and we want to know where you are. So I mean, we don't, I can personally tell you, I have no idea what the hell our heating units are going to be in our various systems. It's just not something. So we need to gather knowledge and come up with something intelligent and systemically. So we appreciate the feedback. We'll take it under consideration. Is that okay?
Yeah, thank you for being
here. Yeah, thanks for coming. And we're up to the time to for a motion to adjourn. Okay, second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.